Welcome to Eclecticist. Eclecticist is an investigation of everything from a fairly British perspective by two brothers who are reasonably normal and sane, and we do this one topic at a time. We are myself, Jeffrey Campos, an engineer and devil's advocate, and my co-host, Benjamin DeCampos, a designer and believer. We generally choose a topic of interest, or field a topic of interest thrust upon us by someone else, spend a vanishingly small time researching it, have a little bit of a think, then we have a discussion, and we publish the notes. The notes are available on our webpage, eclecticist.co.uk. You can download them and read along. We believe that the benefit of this is that we foster a greater understanding of the world around us before we die, and hopefully will prompt further thought and discussion from you, our listeners, and learn a thing or two along the way ourselves. The topic that we're wrestling with this round is gambling. Probability theory is only really fun when money is involved. From a whimsical flutter on the outcome of mechanical racehorses at the arcade, to shorting airlines, to slapping down a barber pole at the top carpet joint, nothing gets the brain opioids pumping like the glamorized institution that is gambling. We all want to be publicly validated for being right, lucky, blessed, smart, or right. The rush of winning big when backing the underdog, the agony when your dead cert team fumbled the ball and cost you the lot, £10 million on the EuroMillions lottery going to a syndicate of 20 neighbours of yours, your last 10 quid in change gone in 3 minutes on your favourite one-armed bandit, only to hear pound coins pumping into the winnings tray when your back is turned at the change cashier. The chance to fill your boots, to corral some well-deserved karma, to pull back a little lady luck in times gone sour. Gambling is entertainingly addictive. How does it work, and what does it want? What we're not going to talk about is gambling, gammon or bling. So, gambling has always been with us. I mean, it goes back since forever, it would seem. I mean, I have never really gambled. I have no real interest in gambling particularly, and I've never really had any contact with gambling or gamblers particularly. But I've always been aware of gambling, and I've always seen it, and I've always seen it in the news, and I've seen the casinos, the online ads, television ads, all sorts. It definitely seems to be all over the place. And yet, I've never really been involved in it. So I thought it might be interesting just to read up on it a little bit and see exactly what it is and how big it is. Do you have any experience with gambling?
I have been in the odd betting shop in my time. I remember as a child, I'd see betting shops and not understand what they are. I'd notice sleazy-looking dudes kind of shamble into them. I remember peering through the screen in front of the door. Do you know, is there a name for that? It's like a bunch of ribbons that hang from the top of the door frame that you can't quite see in.
You're thinking of video shops, really dodgy ones.
Video shops, it's the same kind of screen that you'd have in a dodgy video shop, for sure. There must be a name for it. What is the name of that device?
I know what you mean. It's just a little curtain of ribbons that hangs actually in the doorway.
Just yes.
To prevent you from seeing through the doorway and maybe stopping the odd fly.
I remember betting shops had those, and I remember when I was a child peering in and just seeing a bunch of men smoking, looking bored. Up until relatively recently, betting shops in London, one particular chain of betting shops, have this very outdated photograph of Andre Agassi. Does that sound familiar at all?
As part of their general graphics.
Yeah, on the window. It's like Andre Agassi with that ludicrous hair that he used to wear.
yeah.
But I don't have any actual experience of gambling or being interested in gambling. I do have experience of knowing people who were into gambling, and in one instance, quite a destructive case of gambling. This is definitely an addiction scenario with this one person. Also, the other early experience I have with gambling is Dad, our father, because he used to do something called the pools. Do you remember that? The football pools?
I remember the pools.
Well, he used to drive somewhere and speak to some shady guy and exchange some piece of paper And apparently this is to do with the football pools. So that was before the national lottery. And maybe...
I did not know that.
You didn't know that? It was somewhere in Lake.
I think that was probably before I was adopted.
Oh, maybe. But I've certainly never been interested. Even when there's like gambling fever, if there's some kind of current climate, like the... What's the big horse racing event that people talk
about?
Yeah,
so it'll be sporting. I mean, sporting events are the big ones where people sort of feel the need to place a bet. That and when there's several rollovers in the lottery and people feel the need to place a bet. Because £10 million just isn't enough. It's not worth me betting on. But £100 million,
yeah.
You know, I want a piece of that. So I'm going to bet on £100 million.
I've never actually bet on the lottery. I think I have put like £10 on a horse, some kind of sweepstake that we're all doing at work or something crazy like that. But so it's probably the sporting, the big sporting events is the only time I've ever come close to gambling.
Yeah, it always seems to be sporting events that that gets people all excited and squeezing into the betting shops. And it's funny, my early memories of betting shops were that you couldn't see inside them. They were always, you know, had frosted windows or, you know, double doors or, you know, they went to great lengths to prevent you from even seeing inside the betting shop.
I think it's a legal thing.
That gradually relaxed. And now you have betting shops where you can, you know, from street level, you can see in them and you can see all these bored guys just sort of leaning around. But I mean, some of them have slightly gone up market. I've noticed some coffee concessions inside some. You know, so I think, I assume the laws have been relaxed a little bit on that front. I haven't seen anything along those lines, but certainly you can see inside them now. But there certainly seem to be a lot of betting shops. You know, every high street will have at least one, which is interesting. And again, the casinos and the laws have changed quite dramatically on the casino front, and we'll talk about that. Sporting bets, that's when, you start hearing the odds in the media when they're, you know, especially when an underdog wins. Or recently here we had Wales doing it. Well, I say here in Europe, we had Wales doing extraordinarily well, uncommonly well and unpredictably well in the World Cup. Not the Euro World Cup. It's the Euro football.
Euro 96.
Euro. That's it. Euro 95 or 6. One of the two. And Wales, you know, were actually qualified to get into the competition, which is a first for them ever, I think. The bookies took a beating because, you know, there is one person who put £1 on Wales even qualifying and they won £1 million or something because the odds were so high. I remember big sporting competitions and that attracting betting. But that was about it. I mean, really, apart from that, I just have no memory ever of anybody placing any kind of bet.
I think
whatsoever.
Because you and I are kind of sport phobes, or at least sport coverage phobes, we have less. We're less likely to be suckered into wasting money on gambling.
I suppose, but you mentioned the pools as well, which again is some kind of. I really didn't do any reading on the pools. I've completely forgotten about it, but I remember it being very popular. There was the Littlewoods football pools, which again worked out the cumulative scores through football teams, and you had to just pick winning teams and winning numbers, and it was just an ongoing thing, and you know, you could always win. And of course there were the premium bonds, which is sort of like a government sponsored lottery where you buy these bonds underwritten by the government, and you're automatically entered into a draw. And every now and then, you know, you might win something. And I think a lot of people did. The odds of winning on premium bonds is a lot better than odds on anything else. So when you think of it as an investment, if you're pretty much guaranteed to win, you know, a couple of £100 on the premium bonds, you take that, you consider that as part of the interest. So it actually seems like a reasonable investment. Well, it certainly did decades ago when they first offered this lottery system with the premium bonds. So I guess that's sort of state-backed gambling. So I remember those. But that's about it. That and the ubiquity of betting shops. Mm. And the sleaziness of betting shops. You know, they certainly were always quite sleazy. And maybe a lot of that's just because you couldn't see inside them and you didn't really know what was going on. So maybe it was sleazy only from the point of view of younger folk who didn't know what was going on.
No, they, as I said, as a kid, when I peeked into one, it definitely looks sleazy. Yeah, no doubt about that.
Only because there are clouds of smoke and chaps just leaning about, and probably no ladies. So I think we just moved on. We moved on to state-backed lotteries there. So, you know, the only ones I can think of, I'm sure there may well be more, but the premium bonds and, of course, the lotteries. These are typically national lotteries. And I remember when the British one came in, and I remember at the time when it came in, I thought, hang on a minute, this is meant to be a Christian country. Surely a state-endorsed gambling institution could be a bad idea, morally speaking. But the idea was that it would be a sort of regressive tax on the poor in order to fund things that the middle class and the rich enjoy, like museums and things like that. And I thought, okay, that sounds pretty interesting.
1994, isn't that crazy? It seems like just yesterday or a week ago or a couple of weeks.
Yeah, maybe a three of weeks, perhaps, maybe muscling in on a whole month. A long time ago. And now, of course, we take it for granted. You know, they're everywhere. And I think the way the lottery works in the UK, is it purely scratch card based?
Of course it's not. What are you talking about?
Not scratch card. Not scratch cards. You have a little form that you fill out, and you physically hand that form to a person. Can you do it digitally online or something? Or do you actually have to have that little physical form that you hand in and you get a physical paper receipt?
I have no idea. I've just not kept up with that kind of thing. I imagine it's probably still a case where you have to go in and go to a man in a shop. Otherwise, there might be some risk of cheating. In the same way that I thought voting would be, you could do it from your computer, but you can't. You have to actually go in and physically be there.
Yeah, there's the physical validation of actually going in there. I mean, you would want that anyway. If you're spending a pound on the national lottery. Or I think they've tried to call it Lotto just to fall in line with Europe.
Yeah, it's called Lotto here.
Kind of weird. I don't know if that ever... that worked, didn't it? Lotto. Ridiculous. I think they call it that because they don't want to call it a lottery, because they don't really want you to think that it's immoral gambling.
No, because they wanted to try and remove it from the sound of lottery, the word, because people would say the national robbery.
That's the only explanation. But no, I always see large queues of people at the weekend spending money in the lottery. And, you know, there's in the UK, there's the graphics for the lottery is terrible. The logo for the lottery is like a hand with eyeballs in the palm. I don't know if you've seen it, but it's insane. I'll put this in the show notes, but it never made sense to me what that logo... it's crossed fingers, but it has eyes. Or it's just awful, and I never really understood what it was. I think I understand what it is now, but it's still horrendous looking.
Pan's Labyrinth?
But in the... that was the inspiration, I'm sure, because Pan's Labyrinth came out in 1995.
I think it's 2008.
Whenever I go into any sort of supermarket in this country, they always have, you know, sort of like a small concession near the front of the store, where they sell cigarettes and other small sundry items. And occasionally, if there are too many people at the tills, you can take a basket of shopping to this little sort of concession area, and they sort of snarl at you, but they take it anyway and they beep it through. But next to this cash point till area with cigarettes behind it, they have a lottery card dispenser. So you can pick your little lottery sheets of paper, which have numbers 1 to 42, and you can pick 5 of them or something. And you can lean on this freestanding dispenser to fill in the little boxes, you know, multiple choice exam style. But the little areas that you can lean on are not flat. They're deliberately at an angle. It's like a tree of angled tiny tables. So it's useless for anything else. I mean, you can just about lean your little lottery card up against it and fill in a couple of boxes. But if you want to put your drink on it or, you know, use it for anything else, it's useless. It's deliberately designed, crippled, so you can't use it for anything else. It's like park benches that have dividers, just so you can't lie on it. That kind of thing just always really annoys me. And every time I look at it, that little dispenser tree with its little angled tables, I get really angry. And I think that's scammy. And I thought, yeah, scammy, just like the whole enterprise. The entire lottery itself is just one big giant scam to supplement taxation. And I think that's the way I think of gambling in general. I think it's a scam. It's designed to con you. It takes advantage of your inbuilt desire to get something for nothing or to, you know, because that's what it is. I mean, gambling is fundamentally risking something in order to win something greater, fundamentally speaking. Generally, it's money, but I suppose you can gamble with anything.
Gamble your life. I mean, you
know, yeah, I quite often play with a revolver. So there are lots of ways you can gamble, but we just sort of think of gambling as risking money for monetary gain. So it sort of makes sense. And I guess it greatly appeals to some, not necessarily desperate people, but, you know, a certain portion of the population is more susceptible to sort of the incentives available through gambling. But I mean, surely everybody knows that it's geared against you. I think the way most people think of gambling is that I know it's geared against me, or rather, I know it's geared against, it's geared towards the house, whoever the house is, but it's not necessarily geared against an individual. So, you know, in as far as the national lottery in this country is concerned, you always hear people say, you have to be in it to win it. So you're not going to win anything if you don't play. If you do play, then your probability of winning something is infinitely greater than not playing at all, which is probably true, but the odds of winning anything significant is quite remote in any kind of gambling, but the odds of winning something is not necessarily remote. And what I mean by that is you may win enough to get you hooked and addicted, but you'll never win enough to walk away and live in luxury for the rest of your life. So, you know, it's extremely remote that gambling will ever actually fully pay off for you. And it's more likely that gambling will just take a little bit of your money. And it's less common that gambling will take over your life and destroy you. So I think the net result is stay away, it's evil. So I generally think it's evil.
Well, I think there are some people who, with a kind of healthy penchant for gambling. It's if you treat it as this is entertainment, you know, you go to Vegas or whatever and you have $100 and say, well, you know, I'm not going to go any more than this. And I'm just going to just have a good time, apparently, you know, putting money on various reds in one-armed bandits and all the rest of it. When $100 is gone, well, hey, I had a great time. Bye. And that does exist, but there are people with the addictive personalities who clearly gambling is extremely destructive. And it's the analogy to smoking is actually quite a good one because it's expensive and you're killing yourself.
Yeah, but that's purely down to the person's personality. I mean, I think the drug, the actual active ingredients in cigarettes or whatever it is you're smoking, they're less to do with addiction. It's more to do with you as a human and how you're wired. You are responsible for the addiction.
I don't know about that. I think
the fact that people can become addicted to gambling when there are no drugs involved, you know, adds grist to that mill.
I guess.
I think, you know, it's just, it's who you are and how you function. And I think it's a... gambling is generalized. I mean, it's made itself into, you know, there are lots of different games because gambling is known as gaming. You know, whenever anybody thinks legally about gambling, they always try and emphasize less that it's gambling and emphasize more that it's entertainment and gaming. So things like slot machines, it's one of those things where you can have some money in your pocket. And you'll go up to a slot machine and you'll put your money in the slot machine and you'll lose. Oop, your money's gone. And you think, tuh, and walk away. But then another person will spend all their money in their pocket and they didn't win anything. And then they'll think, well, the next time I'm going to win because I've had this losing streak. You know, karma must reward me. Therefore, I need to, you know, keep putting money in until I win something. And of course, it's a slippery slope because you're spiraling towards, you know, spending a huge amount of money. So it's cruelty that the odds are set to keep you pumping the money into the machine. So a slot machine, you know, if you put enough money into a slot machine, you're going to win. Will you win back all of the money that you've put in it? Unlikely. So, you know, somebody, they have actually sat there, the designers of these games have sat around and they thought, look, how do we gear this machine just so that it will deliver us more than we're investing in it? That, you know, it's a profit and loss calculation.
Yeah, but how is that different from anything else at all? Like, for example, people who make burgers, they probably sit around saying, look, how can we make people buy more of our burgers?
Yeah, it's different. It's different because when you go to buy a burger, you know how much it costs. The price is on the burger. So you go in, you go, that's $5. $5 for a burger, that's outrageous. That's $10. $10 is a daylight robbery. This is $50 for a burger. What is this, the Olympic Park? Whereas with a gambling machine, it's however much money you feel you need to pump into it.
Yeah, I guess.
There's no stopping point. They don't want you to stop. Famously, the casinos in Las Vegas, they don't have any windows. They have the same lighting all the time. You think it's the, you know, there's no clocks. They don't want you to know how much time is passing by. They want you to stay in there forever. So I just think it's so predatory in its very fiber as an industry. I can definitely see the moral condemnation of gambling in general. I think it's a science of taking advantage of human nature and you know, particular individuals. You know, it's a bell curve like everything. So, you know, some people will be fine with it. Some people will feel quite angry that they lost a lot of money. And other people will be just fall into a horrible cycle of addiction. Who's to blame?
Well, it sounds like there's a kind of a moral quandary here. And so I looked into the Bible to see what the Bible has to say about all this kind of stuff. Because I've heard various chatter about how it's very unbiblical. Gambling is unbiblical. So when you have people who are ostensibly religious gambling, you know, you point to them and say, well, God wouldn't have gambled, whatever. But I couldn't actually find anything that's that explicit in the Bible. So I've got these couple of little passages here. Well, just one, for example, and they're all basically like this. So in Mark 8:36, for what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? And like everything else in the Bible, you can interpret that to anything, really.
That could mean anything. That could mean how many bananas you're going to eat next week.
Yeah, or how are you going to be killed by bananas?
Indeed. Or whether or not bananas could achieve consciousness and just take over.
Or whether you could grow bananas out of your forehead.
Or how many bananas you could win in a card game. I mean, yeah, I couldn't find anything in the Bible. There's nothing explicitly condemning gambling in the Bible that I could find.
But you found, what's it that you put this in here, from the Quran?
Oh, the Quran, yeah, in Surah 5, verse 90 or so, there's a fairly explicit condemnation. It says in English, O you who have believed, indeed, intoxicants, gambling, stone altars, as in sacrificing on stone altars, to anything other than Allah, and divining arrows are but defilement from the work of Satan. So avoid it that you may be successful. So that's a fairly straightforward condemnation of gambling in the Quran. So, you know, so it's not Quranic. And yet, you know, we have loads of bingo halls in this country called Mecca. I don't know where that came from.
Really? Oh, but, that's right. Yeah.
How odd. And bingo, I mean, you know, how predatory is that on older folk?
No, but that's not quite the same. Because there is much more, in my opinion, of an entertainment component to bingo. It's
well,
fun.
I think
it's
so
exciting.
Because, yeah, and you know somebody in the room is going to win.
Ah, yes.
Which is great. So you know it's one of us. You know, you're looking at other people and, you know, there's a sense of camaraderie. There's a sense of competition. There's a sense of climax. You know, there's a climax to it where there isn't with the National Lottery. I mean, I don't know if you've ever watched the National Lottery program, But when they read out the winning numbers, you know, they have this big tombola-looking thing that has bouncing balls inside it. It's a big glass sphere, and there are loads of numbered balls bouncing about, and some quasi-celebrity will call the numbers as they come out. And then when they call the final number, you know, the winning number, presumably, you know, if you have all five numbers or however many numbers there are, you could win millions. But of course, it's on television and it's live, and they read out the numbers and they go, and the final number is 14.
And people cheer.
The probability of somebody in that studio jumping up and going, "I've won," is, you know, really super remote. It's going to be somebody at home who probably didn't even realize they won. So it's a total anticlimax, complete anticlimax. Mm. Whereas that's not the case with, you know, I mean, in casinos, you always hear the sound of the slot machines paying out somewhere, you know, and it's a very loud, deliberately loud sound. You know, it really, really is super loud. Boom, 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 boom. And all the money hitting the symbol-like winning tray at the bottom. So you think, ooh, somebody's won. And then, you know, I think as a human, you'll immediately start calculating the odds. Hang on a minute, that person won. That sounds like he won a lot out of that machine. You know, the conspiracy theories will start racing around in your mind. Oh, they've probably muted all the other machines so there isn't another big payout. You know, maybe I should leave. Or you know, that person, you know, how did they get that lucky? You know, so you're constantly trying to you're thinking hard as a gambler, I think. You're constantly trying to weigh up the odds. And you know, there's because not that many people know that much about probability theory, especially not, you know, after they've had a few drinks and they're in the environment. They're madly trying to calculate the odds, and they're making up a bunch of, you know, a lot of it is woo. A lot of it is purely, I have a hunch. It's karma. It's payback. It's blowback. You know, they have these little theories. You know, there's lots of strange quirks that gamblers have that, you know, famously, they'll do crazy things like, you know, before they go, they'll walk backwards into a casino, or you know, the Chinese will only ever use the back door of a casino. They'll never go through the front door of a casino.
But don't you speak to your bowling ball?
Yeah. I mean, you know, you lick your bowling ball before you throw it down the alley. So I guess that's a sporting thing. You know, everybody, you always have a little bit of control over how you're going to play, or you have a little bit of control over what the outcome might be. In gambling, I think there's so little control of the outcome. You have to sort of make up a sense of control of the outcome. So, you know, the way I pull the arm on a one-armed bandit, that has something to do with the outcome. Or maybe I can steer the outcome of craps by the way you know which hand you throw the dice with, or, you know, it's I don't know, there's a lot of religion in it, I guess. I think you have to, it requires a lot of faith, gambling, if you want to win. I mean, maybe, and it's hard to believe that there's anybody out there who really only is interested in the entertainment value. I mean, I suppose in a big casino where there are lap dancers and shows and, you know, the atmosphere, and, you know, I suppose you can go in and, you know, you have a budget of money and you don't care if you win or not. It's irrelevant. You just want to be there. I suppose that happens. But when you actually put a coin in a slot of a slot machine, you want to win. I don't think you want to lose. You know, you think to yourself, it would be great if I just put this, I just walked in and put a quarter in this one-armed bandit and it pumps out the maximum win. You know, I will walk away. If it gives me $500, I will walk straight out of this casino and I will have been a winner.
Well, people who do win at gambling, assuming that there are such people, assuming that that happens, I think it's all in knowing when to stop. So as soon as something like that does happen, that's when you walk out the door. Don't turn around now because you're not welcome anymore.
Yeah, but then there's another factor that comes into play. If somebody wins big, I mean, again, using slot machines as the example, if you've played for, you know, you're on a holiday to Las Vegas for 2 weeks and you've played the slot machines every single day for an hour, and, you know, you're on your final day of your holiday and you win $1,000 on a slot machine and everybody's applauding and, you know, you get a little bit of fame for a couple of minutes in the casino.
It's so seducing.
Maybe the casino owner comes down and says, you know, wow, fantastic. And nobody's won this for, you know, X amount of time. And not only am I going to, we're giving you, we're not only are we paying out $1,000, you know, have a free steak dinner on our restaurant or whatever. And you're thinking, wow, this is fantastic. I love gambling. Definitely coming back here next year.
No, that's not how it happens. The opposite happens. It's, for example, people who are weirdly autistic when it comes to calculating things, you know, people geniusly good at mathematics and stuff, they can be banned from casinos because they just win too much. And that,
yeah, that's repeat winning. If you have a one-off win, right, think about the PR. If you win big in a casino, absolutely they're going to be extremely ecstatically happy for you and say, you know, that's fantastic. You know, well done. You won the game. Now don't come back. No, you know, well done. And just keep gambling and, you know, not gambling, but keep patronizing us. And
but as soon as you come in,
if you're winning a lot or repeatedly, then obviously you're going to get the CCTVs swinging over in your direction as you walk in, and they'll think that you're cheating in some way. Or, you know, lots of people have been caught blackjack, and there are lots of games and casinos that you can calculate and you can, you know, count. You can do card counting, and there's lots of ways of, I suppose, cheating. And certainly the house doesn't want you to do that. And certainly the house doesn't want to lose because it's a business. They're businesses. You know, they want to win. People manufacture fruit machines because it's an investment. You know, they're not making fruit machines to entertain you. They're making fruit machines to pull in revenue. That's what it's for. Entertainment is a side benefit, I think, generally speaking. These are businesses and they want you to pay. I think the Americans do it better than anybody because they've built it into such an industry that you can benefit from these side benefits. So, you know, you can go along and be a winner in that you get all the enjoyment from the ambiance and the entertainment without having to really focus on the gambling. There's more than just the gambling there, but the gambling fuels everything else. So you can benefit from everything that the gambling is delivering for you. So it's one of those things, you know, people are different. And I certainly think it's your wiring that gets you into gambling to a deleterious extent. So we've spoken about how sport is a big motivator for gambling. And that's natural because sport is generally competitive. I don't think there are any non-competitive sports. I don't know. Is yoga in the Olympics?
Is that a sport?
But I don't think. I hope not. So sport is naturally competitive, and people really, really desperately want to win, and not just for money, but you know, a lot of sports people are extremely passionate about whatever it is they do, and maybe they feel they're particularly gifted at whatever it is they do. And when they become successful, you know, they absolutely want to win. They want to be number one, not just to have the golden trophy and the payout, but they actually want to be number one. They want to have the record that stands for 100 years and whatever it is they do. And because of this drive to be number one and this drive to win, it naturally attracts gambling. So, you know, I immediately think football, where you can, you know, the bets are on absolutely everything. The bookies generate odds on every possible Boolean result that you could have out of two teams fighting it out. And that's, is it going to be a draw? Is one team going to beat the other team? Is it going to be extra time? Will a player be sent off with a red card? Which player? Which team? And, you know, the odds ratios can just go insane. You know, you can go to a bookie and say, look, I'm going to give you £1 on this player getting a red card in the second half of the game. And the bookmaker will consider it and they'll think, okay, well, I know what you're trying to do here, Mr. Gambler. You want me to give you astronomical odds of this happening. And if it does happening, our entire business goes under. It's not worth it for me, but make it £1,000 that you're putting down and I'll lower the odds a little bit and then we'll call it a deal. So you can always think of anything with a bookmaker and place the bet and hope, if it's legal, that you'll actually get paid if whatever it is you've bet on comes true. And obviously, the enterprise is going to want you to wriggle out of it. They're like insurance companies. They don't really want to pay out ever. And if they absolutely have to pay out, they'll still think of ways to try and get out of it. So I'd be nervous if I ever won a large amount from anybody, because you would immediately think, are they going to pay out? They'll think of something. They'll say, ah, well, you didn't cross this T and dot this I, therefore it's you know, you win nothing. So that's scary. The stress of just that in gambling, am I going to get my money if I win? It's stress. That's real overhead that you have to consider in the entire process. So gambling, I'm put off from gambling by that sort of stress and lots of other stressors, you know, just hoping that you're going to win and hoping that the result is going to be good and considering what you're going to lose. Why, how that is attractive, I just don't understand it. I mean, I just don't understand it. It's a confluence of factors that make it so appealing, I think.
Hmm.
Have you had a flutter on any sporting event? The Grand National, perhaps?
Apart from the Grand National, at some point a long time ago, when everyone else was doing it, I don't think I won anything. It's just not my bag. So Vegas, baby. So we kind of spoke about Vegas a little bit. I went to Vegas as an adult, as they say here, last year or the year before, and it was pretty boring.
If you're not into gambling,
yeah, it's just casinos. Casinos aren't interesting. This is boring, and you kind of look around to see who's actually finding this kind of thing interesting, and all walks of life. But I think had someone come out and said, "Hey, hello there, come and sit down at this table. We'll teach you how to do this. Do you like loose craps, you know," and explained all these different terms to us and stuff, we probably would have maybe enjoyed it. I would like to think that we would be the high-functioning gambling person by saying, okay, well, we're going to gamble this much money because it's just tonight's entertainment, and we'll just walk away once this pile of money is depleted, for example. But it's just exactly what you see in the films. It's just big, huge hall of gambling machines and tables and all that kind of thing.
I think if you're into a particular game, you know, if you get to know a particular game and understand how it's played, in a casino environment, you'll gravitate towards it. And I think you can probably build an appreciation for a particular game.
Right.
Because they are games. For instance, I mean, Texas Hold'em is a very popular casino game. And it's very easy to learn, and it's very sound. You know, the way it works, the mechanics of the game are quite logical and consistent and cohesive, to the point where whoever wins, you can understand why they won, and it, you never feel like you've been robbed in any way. And it can be quite complex and quite compelling. And, of course, you can learn to play it at home, and you can play for, you know, popcorn kernels or whatever non-monetary value you might want to play for. So it can be, you know, a very enjoyable evening playing poker with friends without, you know, the money aspect.
Oh, that's different. And so,
but is it different? Just because we've removed money, you know, it can still become addictive, and you can still desperately want to win, and you can still lose big.
Yeah.
So
I just think that's different. Like playing poker with your friends and not for money is
would you classify that as gambling, or is that not gambling?
I guess it's maybe that would be gambling light. Clearly, we've already established in this conversation, we've already established that there is a spectrum. There's like crazy destructive gambling, like at one end, and this sort of ramp down to light gambling with chips with your buddies, or it could be, I don't know, something like that.
Yeah, because you're not really losing anything, no. I don't think. It's like Monopoly. You could say, is Monopoly gambling? Well, not really, because you're not walking into the room with something and then walking out of the room without something materially or more of something. It's a tabletop game. I suppose there are risks, but I wouldn't classify it as gambling. So I think this gaming umbrella that seems to incorporate everything, I think, is I think that's not appropriate. I think that's a legal thing.
I think that's purely euphemistic.
Yeah, it is euphemistic. Indeed it is. So I think, yeah, it's the money element. You know, it's an investment. You know, it's like you're buying something.
Mm.
You're buying something that you may or may not have delivered to you.
Yeah.
You're not buying the experience. You're buying as an investment.
Is that a little iPhone, little tool that you have in your hand just then?
Yeah,
that's a little thing. I know about that because I had to. I've recently been through a few phones after I had the swimming pool disaster. The SIM cards have and the case survived as well, which I'm grateful for. So that's
good. That's totally sealed, though. So that makes sense.
You know, but even so, it's still got guts inside of it. There's still some kind of electronics that actually plugs into your phone and has some kind of brain of sorts. Anyway, so casinos are interesting because I remember one of my first experiences with a casino was in London town. It was a work do that I had at this company I was working at, and the boss, in a very misjudged way, decided that some of us he was going to take to a casino, and we got to see what he does with all this money that we earn for him. And I saw with my own eyes in my head just how much money goes to the house. It's like, so you put money on the table, or, you know, chips on the table, essentially money. And after each round, it's just there's a guy there with this huge dustpan and brush who then just shovels all the chips into this hole in the table. So underneath the table, there's this huge pile of chips that each night they go in.
It just falls into his lap.
Yeah, pretty much.
And as he's wearing a skirt, he can actually hold quite a bit.
But it's just looking around at everyone else there. It's like, hey, everyone else here, can you see what's going on here? Are you too blinded by the seductive, I don't know, aura of what it is you're doing that you can't notice that all your money is just going to this house, going to the house, I should say. So, I mean, that was a little bit like what you'd do to try and stop someone from smoking. You'd say, oh, go on, smoke this pack of cigarettes, and they'd be sick. And mm-hmm. in some instances, I'm sure that stops them from ever touching a cigarette again. So that's kind of what that was.
Yeah. It's odd. I mean, there's a big casino on Leicester Square. It's absolutely vast casino that's, I think it's been some sort of casino for over 100 years, and it was fairly recently modernized, and now it's a, you know, it has every possible casino game in it. It has a cabaret, it has a theater, it has multiple restaurants. It's just vast, but it's free. You can go in. You can just walk in off the street.
You don't need to be a member.
Nothing like that. You literally walk in off the street, and you can just watch everything, and, you know, buy a drink, and just sit there, and just spend no money at all and enjoy it for all the interesting characters that are wandering around and the amazing games and the big losses and wins that you witness. It's very entertaining. It's open 24/7, absolutely every single day. Christmas Day, it's open. So you can walk in at any time. You know, a lunch break, you can walk in there and just have a look. And it's interesting because on the main gaming floor, you have lots of card games, you know, blackjack and poker and all the rest of it. Pontoon. And all the croupiers are mostly women, and they have large cleavages that are on display. Without fail. That is the dress code. And that's interesting. I mean, I guess it keeps you coming back to the table, I guess, if you have your eye on a particular croupier and you're more likely to spend more money with them. I'm sure that is the case. That is the case. But it also, you know, I didn't see very many men, but I'm sure there are men. But they didn't have their cleavages showing. So I'm thinking perhaps men are more likely to spend more money in or frequent casinos and gaming houses more than women, perhaps. I think that might be true. So you might think men are more likely to take risks than women. So I'm sort of extrapolating out here, but potentially men take more risks than women. I think that's not controversial to say. So gambling is more leaning towards appealing to men than women.
Yeah, I think gambling, or what you just described, is a kind of seedy underworld that probably most of us aren't even aware of. But in the upper, there are the upper echelons of society that contain people with a lot of money, and they are base. Things like what you just said appeal to them, and they go there to spend all the money that their employees have made for them. And they're the kind of people who do stuff like that, the kind of people who go to African countries to go and shoot beautiful animals, go to these all these lap dancing clubs. And it's just like the worst kind of human debauchery, you know, the definition of empty hedonism that happens. And I think gambling, like you described, is nestled in there.
Mm. I think so. So again, it's down to the wiring of particular people and the taking advantage of those people through scientific means, through the supply and demand of for-profit capitalism. But it's very interesting to watch it in action, especially when you know you're a real outsider, as you say. You know, if you have no interest in gambling, you've had no collision with gambling in any way, then when you do see it, it just seems the weirdest thing. I mean, I guess it's a lot like religion. If you're not a religious person and you see or you participate in, or not participated, but you're in close proximity to religious ceremonies or rituals, it seems utterly alien and you just can't believe this is actually happening and that those people over there are taking this deadly seriously. It is one of those odd aspects of human behavior, I think, which doesn't get as much coverage as it should. But hey, we're trying here. As far as glamorization is concerned, so if we talk about advertising, I know there are strict limits on what and how gambling can be advertised. But I do see ads. And I see ads in all the usual sorts of places. I see it on television, typically after a certain time in the evening. I have memories of seeing gambling on television. I don't really watch television anymore, so perhaps it's not on television any longer. I see advertisements for gambling on public transport a lot. There are always ads for, especially online casinos. So there's quite a lot of online gambling outlets. So I'm not quite sure how that works. I know there are mobile phone apps and tablet apps, and you can play, but with real money. So presumably it works exactly as it would in a casino. It's just that it's online and, you know, you stand to win or lose however much money. I can't see that as being appealing. I mean, that's just directly catering to problem gamblers, I would have thought, because there's no other appeal at all. You know, you're holding up your phone and using an app just like you would with any other app. What's the benefit? It just seems peculiar. Except if you win, you know, maybe you'll throw your phone up in the air or throw it into the nearest swimming pool. It just seems bizarre. But there's an awful lot of money being spent on advertising for these things.
I threw my phone into the nearest swimming pool and I didn't win anything.
No? You just won the opportunity to spend a couple of $100 on a new phone.
I didn't even have my old phone scratched up. It's like, it would have been great had I had a big, huge crack in the screen or something. And it's like, oh, good. It's giving me an excuse to get a new phone. But it was like pristine. It was like a kind of, you know, imagine, I don't know. You just remember that film Beetlejuice? Where
yes.
The dead, when they were ghosts, how they looked depends on how they died. And so the two protagonists in the film looked just like normal people because they drowned. So yes. The same with my phone. It just looked like a perfect working phone, except it didn't work.
Yes, that's the worst kind of phone. One step on from advertising is glamorization. Generally, where did the glamorous appeal of gambling come from? Is it just the silver screen? Because when I think of gambling at the cinema, I think, you know, right back to the 40s films. You know, things like Gilda, which is about a casino with Rita Hayworth. One of my favorite films, in fact. And, you know, it's set in a casino. It's a lot about gambling. And it does make it look very interesting. You know, it looks like a big party. You know, everybody's dressed up in their finest dancing gear. And they're out to an extremely glamorous building. You know, it's like a big party. So it's the party atmosphere, which is the initial draw.
You know what I think it is? I think it's something very primitive. I think because you've got potentially very wealthy people go to casinos. And if someone puts a lot of money on something and then it comes up, then suddenly that already glamorous person looks even more attractive. And then so people will then flock around that person because he's now a superstar, because he was already amazing and now he's just won all this money.
Yeah, possibly. I mean, it's the ability to gather resources, I guess. But yeah, and maybe the person who has just won a whole bunch of money, maybe their luck will rub off on you, literally.
Literally, you know, what does that mean?
As in you're cozying up to that person. And, right. You know, in the films, they'll cozy up to them and then he'll say, hey, why don't you throw my dice? And it's like, okay, yeah. Okay. You, lovely lady, I want you to blow on my dice. You know, no undercurrent there at all.
It does require a belief in the supernatural. So I think, as you you said earlier, it's like everyone seems to be, oh, that's my lucky so-and-so.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I think so. Yeah, there's a definite faith element.
Lucky butt plug.
Exactly. That sort of thing. I mean, if you win big, I suppose the first thing you do, even before punching the air and going, yeah, in your face, everybody else, you'll look at what you're wearing and you'll think, okay, so why did I just win? Is it because I have on this belt hole and you know, I have odd socks on? Oh my God, that's what it is. And you think, you know, how can people be so dumb? But I don't know. Luck and faith and irrationality are just so part of who we are that I think it's almost reasonable to expect people to behave this way. Mm. I don't know. You know, I think it's very peculiar. Yeah, so there are a lot of films about gambling. Some of them are more interesting than others. There's The Hustler, the classic, you know, hustling gambling. There is a film by Andrew Niccol, one of my favorite directors, in fact, called In Time. And this is a film about a dystopian future where you grow to be 25 years of age and then you stop aging. Everybody gets to 25 and they're 25 forever.
Mm.
But once you reach on your 25th birthday, a clock starts ticking down. So you have a certain amount of time, maybe a couple of years, until you die. And you can get more time by working for it. So time becomes currency. So the richer you are, the longer you have to live. And you can donate your time that you have, you know, you can give, it's a currency. So, you know, you have a clock that's ticking down on a moving tattoo on your arm. And when you buy a coffee, it sucks away 20 minutes of your time. You want to get a bus, it's, you know, half an hour of your time taken away. You can donate your time to other people, or you can gamble for more time. So you can go to a casino and literally gamble away your life. And I thought that's an excellent take on gambling in general. And it was particularly interesting in that you had the lower caste people who live day by day for time. You know, they literally have 24 hours on their little moving tattoo. So, you know, they're constantly right on the edge of dying. And then you have the elites who have centuries of time on their little moving tattoos. You know, they're so relaxed about the whole situation. They have no idea how hard it is knowing that you could be dead in the morning. Fascinating. I thought that was quite a good commentary on the moral ills of gambling. As far as literature is concerned, God, I just couldn't think of anything at all. Specifically about gambling. I mean, I keep thinking about James Bond novels and, you know, how there's always some dice on the cover and a golden cufflink and a gun. But Dostoevsky's The Gambler, which I did read when I was a kid, but God, I don't have any memory of that at all. That was about it. There's not much else there that I could think of in terms of gambling and books. But, you know, it's always a theme, but it's never the theme that I could find. I don't know if you've ever read anything specifically about the roulette wheel.
Nope. Maybe a Bond thing, but yeah.
And in music, I guess there's always lots of references to gambling. You know, usually negative references to gambling problems. It seems that half of the entire catalog of country music is about problem gamblers.
Is it?
It's always pretty depressing.
What, yeah, like?
There are loads of country tunes about gamblers and gambling. I can't think of anything specifically, but whenever I do listen to any proper country music, it's really depressing.
There's a lot of alcoholism, surely. I've never heard.
Love that was either unrequited, love that was gambled away, love that actually gambled away, or just, you know, failed relationships, just failure, basically, misery. It's country music in general.
Well, Lemmy from Motorhead, he wrote and sang the Ace of Spades, and at the end of the day, he died.
He did. So the Ace of Spades didn't really work out for him now, did it? Yeah, there's a whole concept album, as you've put here, Turn of a Friendly Card, the Alan Parsons Project. Yeah, that was, you know, a very thoughtful piece about gambling, I thought. And it was pretty depressing, so I think it's a negative take. Even though the title might lead you to think otherwise. But is there a friendly card? I don't know. You know, is that the card game with the prophetic card game?
I don't know. I thought that was like a term that was used elsewhere, like a friendly card in gambling. But I couldn't find anything. It seemed every time if I did a Google search for friendly card, it would come up with the Alan Parsons Project album.
Well, I just think it means you've turned a card that benefits you. It's friendly to you. Because there are lots of games. There are lots of games where you're dealt cards face down. Yeah. Yeah, you're dealt cards face down. So when you turn that card and it's a good one, you can win the game. So, you know, poker, for instance, you know, you get blind cards. So you don't know what it is. And that's where your luck may lie. So, you know, it's a really big part of culture in general. It's a good thing sometimes for entertainment's sake. I mean, the only good you can pull out of it is always to the disadvantage of somebody else. So I suppose you could argue that a state-backed lottery system is good in that the winnings, the money that players who play to win put in is invested into, you know, social good and supplements taxation. So, you know, it prevents the taxes from rising by helping communities invest in community benefit, which is a good thing. But it does so to a moral ill, I would have thought. I mean, I can certainly see the point that protests may level at gambling and lottery specifically. You know, it's inciting sin almost and increasing the odds of developing problem gamblers, I suppose. You know, it turns people into gamblers who might not otherwise be gamblers because you have a large investment in awareness. You know, they spend a lot of money in advertising the national lottery and that you should play and that it's easy to play. They make it easy, it's accessible, but it's gambling. And you could say, you know, play the national lottery because we look at what it's done for these charities and look at what it's done for this old theater building or this listed building or this museum. And that's all wonderful, you know, and these are deserving causes, but you're still saying, you know, gamble. Rather than saying, just give us your money. If you say, you know, donate to these worthy charities because they're worthy, just give us your money. But to sort of sucker people in by saying, oh, you know, and you may win big on the lottery, you know, dream big. There's just something that doesn't rub me well about that. I just think ethically it's not how we should be steering society particularly. Even if everybody understands it. I mean, even if everybody is completely clued up on exactly what's going on, exactly why you're doing it and how you're doing it, it still seems a little bit peculiar to me that, again, a Christian, nominally Christian country like the UK would endorse it, you know, so extensively as it does. So I think ethics is a consideration, and one must take a sort of moral view on inculcating people into gambling away their money. But, you know, if people, it's voluntary, it's not enforced, so I guess you have the argument that free will, you know, people have their own minds and they can do what they like. But you know, it's terrible when people do develop an addiction problem. I mean, there's a statistic here, according to the NHS, 593,000 problem gamblers in Great Britain. So half a million people with a problem, you know, an actual problem where they'll hurt themselves and potentially others through gambling. Is it a price worth paying? Is there anything else? I mean, this is something, we're really so far out of our sort of comfort zone with gambling because we just have no experience of it whatsoever. It's really difficult to talk about at any length.
Well, just the personal anecdotes. So I knew someone who was one of these people, just like needed to go and spend money on gambling, whether it be in a pub, you know, the betting machines at a pub. What are they called? Fruit machines. Yeah. In a pub. You would just like chug pound coins into it. And then betting shops, all that kind of thing. And it's that kind of classic case of addiction where they can somehow bury the reality of the true destruction of what they're doing and just continue putting money in these machines, paying money to bookies, all of this kind of thing, because it's definitely going to pay out big time next time. And the other one was really recently with a Uber driver of mine who said he was going to go to Vegas. And it's like, yeah, okay, cool. Have fun. And he goes, yeah, a friend of mine, he's a professional gambler. And it's like, what the hell are you talking about? So this is a guy that, for a living, this is what he does. And that doesn't sound like...
So he's like a day trader at home.
Well, yeah, there's that. Actually, we didn't talk about that. But he goes to casinos for a living. And so he currently...
He has a desk there.
Yeah.
The stapler and a phone.
So he is able to gamble and then have enough of a return to live. But he says he lost like $24,000 like in one evening. That doesn't sound good. And to me, it sounds like there's a ticking time bomb above this guy's head.
Well, maybe. I mean, you know, there are professional poker players who are millionaires. I mean, you know, they are the best of
That's
the best.
Endorsement deals, Jeff.
Well, no, I suppose there's an element of skill, though. I mean, we didn't consider the skill required for certain games. So poker, you could argue that actually there's skill involved. So if there's skill involved and you have some sort of control over the outcome, then you can train, presumably, and get better at it. Whereas other games are, you know, pure luck. It's just pure luck. You have no control over it unless you're psychokinetic in some way. So I suppose you could make a living out of something that you're good at. And if it happens to be poker or another game where skill is an advantage, then can't imagine it'd be very many people who do this, but... Or successfully, that is, and sustainably. But I'm sure it happens. But I mean, is that gambling then? If you can actually become good at it, then I don't know. I mean, it's like anything else. It doesn't seem to be, to me, to be gambling particularly.
Hmm.
You know, maybe, again, I'm sure there are lots of different directions. It's an umbrella term, let's say, and there are lots of different extents where you could win or lose. And as you say, we didn't mention stocks and trades and playing the stock market and buying shares. And because, you know, you can look at trends in the market and you can buy shares one day in a company and then sell them the next day and hoping to sell.
Although with
sell high and buy low.
With the big market traders that get most of the headlines, the key difference there is they're not gambling with their own money.
Yes. Yeah, they're professionally gambling with somebody else's money.
It's a lot easier when you do it that way.
A nice job if you can get it. Yeah. Especially when there's no reprisals if you blow the lot.
Yeah.
Which is casino banking and how it works. So yeah, there's that. I suppose gambling, it's you can gamble with somebody else's money. I mean, I suppose if somebody thinks somebody else is lucky, they might say, look, can you play my round? You know, you look like you're more likely to win than I am. I've been on this fruit machine for an hour and I haven't won a thing, but I know it's coming. Can you hurry it up a little bit by playing the next round or some craziness like that? So again, you know, faith creeps in through the back door. Interestingly enough, yeah, the Chinese, they really do come in through the back door. that Hippodrome, London's Hippodrome casino, which I went to, the owner said, you know, they don't want to pass the boss, so they don't want to walk past me at the front door. So we built a special door at the back, which just happens to lead out into Chinatown. And that's the door that they come in through for superstitious reasons. So, you know, it's superstition all the way down, I think. And, you know, in the cold light of day, you look at the odds and you just know it's a scam. So people who become addicted to it, presumably people who become addicted know all about it, and they know how it works, and they know the mechanism, and they know everything. But they just maintain this crazy conspiracy theory level belief that they can beat the odds, or, you know, they're somehow due a big payout. Mm. It's very peculiar. Mm. Well, if there's nothing else, if you think we've plumbed the depths enough of the big casinos,
isn't it plunged?
And we no longer stand a chance of winning anything, I think we should call it quits and cash in our chips. You have been listening to Eclecticist. We have a webpage, eclecticist.co.uk, where you can have a look at all of our previous shows. You can suggest topics for new shows, and you can see information on upcoming shows. And of course, you can have a look at all the notes that we publish online. Any feedback would be great. There's a form at the bottom of the page. We don't know what we're going to be talking about next week, so, you know, if you have a suggestion, pop it along. You have been listening to us this evening, not any sort of interlopers. And thank you very much for listening, and we'll see you next time. Thank you.